The Maverick Surf Contest is on tomorrow, Friday, 24th of January, and I will not be there. I will be here because what we're doing here is more important than the Maverick Surf Contest. In fact, it's more challenging by far than the Maverick Surf Contest. It is literally dropping out of death, dropping out of death, dropping out of impermanence, dropping out of the nightmare. And I've been using the technique of, I don't have a crisis problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a dot, 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 any, you know, awareness problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a consciousness problem, I have a continuity problem. Anything that arises in your mind thinking this is a concern, a problem, turn around and say, I don't have that, I have a continuity problem. And this morning I woke up and I was lightheaded and a little bit uncoordinated, and eventually during the daytime I finally said, wow, this what's going on? I took my blood pressure and had low blood pressure, so but I feel a little better now, actually. So there was an effect, of a little bit of low blood pressure. It was like, what, 106 over 60 or something like that. And it wasn't enough blood getting to my head, I guess. I was feeling a little unstable and not like vertigo, but so there's something to report. But I'm gotten through it. I was able to function today and work today. It was a little bit difficult, actually. So there you go. There's a little bit of a reaction taking place. There's obviously an enormous bonfire at some level of my being. Now, it's important to explain that you cannot explain certain very key concepts. What I have found is that you work, you try to understand, you do everything possible, and you just don't get it. And one day, for some reason, you just see it, the whole thing, you just see it. And you realize it's beyond what you can explain. You cannot understand it through explanations. What good then is anybody? Reassurance, encouragement to keep working, keep trying. Because it is there. There is this aha moment. Now, I had an aha moment several days ago, maybe about a week ago, when I was putting together the Ramana Maharshi quotes. And he talks about somebody going and digging a hole. And he says, with dirt, you know, digging a hole in the ground. And he says the hole is now, is filled up with space now, right? There, you look at the hole and you say there's space there. But what he says is, there was always space there. And that, like, just struck me. And I realized I'd never thought of it that way. And it's just this incredible breakthrough. And it's very difficult to explain. But we believe that there are things in space. In spaciousness. This thing is in spaciousness. But where is, from this edge to this edge, is the thing, is there not spaciousness also as this thing? Is spaciousness devoid in this thing? Where there's this thing and then there's spaciousness? Is that accurate? So Ramana is saying, look, you can see the spaciousness when you take the dirt out, but when the dirt was there, the area that the dirt occupied, that is in spaciousness. That area, there's nowhere where spaciousness isn't. Never seen it before that way. And this is kind of trying to dawn upon me bit by bit now. If you start thinking about it, it's not easy at all. Intellectually, it's not on the level of intellect. the real breakthroughs are not on the level of cleverness or intellect. You might say they're even beyond the level of smartness. Most of the world is just cleverness. A little bit of smartness. Some people have a little bit of smartness. But this is more of a seeing, you know, a realization, a seeing, the spaciousness that is a different way of seeing, a simple change. So there isn't any way for anyone to really explain to anyone else, and anyone else says, "Oh, okay, I get it. It's not possible." That's what I've seen. I know a lot of some teachers, they're trying to explain, "Yeah, it's like this. it doesn't work." But the efforts to try, at some point, there's some sort of gestalt breakthrough. It's a gestalt is like having all sorts of dots or lines or outlines that's only partial. And then somehow we are able to then see the whole that's not really there. As far as the lines go, the lines do not really truly delineate it, but we're able to kind of fill in the gaps. And then when we fill in the gaps, we get this whole picture instead of just these dots or dashes or lines or something. We have the ability to do that. But if there's someone who doesn't see it, you keep explaining, well, this line here is a contour here, and this is that, and then this will go, and it trying to piece it together doesn't really work. So you have this sort of this gestalt breakthrough. And that Ramana saying, just taking the dirt out of the hole, I said, "Well, wait a minute. What do you mean? What does he mean? The space was there already?" Wow. And that pointed out that I've been seeing things wrong. This is a habit. This is habit. I think almost everybody does this. Is we don't realize. We think that there are these things in spaciousness, but the spaciousness is not in the things. It's outside of the things. And I still have not. I'm struggling with this. You see, struggling with it. If you try to figure it out intellectually, it doesn't seem to work very well. Which is why I recommend the mood of repentance, because from the mood of repentance, you can have this aha gestalt-like moment where suddenly it's all clear to you. But you have to be in the mood of repentance because it's a severe blow to the intellect. Severe blow. Because you realize, oh my gosh, the intellect never saw this, never told me this. Doesn't see it, doesn't realize it, can never understand it. It's like, uh-oh. So the mood of repentance is important to absorb that kind of shock. Like, oh my gosh, I wasn't nearly as smart as I thought I was. Or the intellect is not really that smart. It's missing this key, something so incredibly important. So it's a very sobering thing. I'm feeling it right now. It's very sobering, and it can have a mild effect on one's physiology, I would say. I would say it has a mild effect. All the work I've been doing on this affirmation of I don't have a life problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a psychological problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have, you know, a developmental problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fear problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a death problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a body problem, I have a continuity problem. All of this, I think, had something to do with feeling a little bit lightheaded, and the blood pressure getting a little bit low. So you don't necessarily want to overdo it. For instance, drink a bunch of, you know, energy drinks, and for the next 3 days, you know, go at this ferociously. I always recommend that do it, pace yourself like a marathon during the day. Today, I spent a lot of time using this affirmation, but not every minute, and there were lots of breaks in between and other stuff. But just sort of continue it every day. The everydayness is what really helps you. The everyday effort is what really succeeds. There is no magic pill you can take, really. It's the everyday effort that succeeds. I think if you look at anyone who's actually finally succeeded, for instance, in seeing spaciousness as it really is, they would say that it's the everyday effort that they made. And then someday, finally, it just clicked, and they just realized it. It was just a full realization. Now, you can have many little mini realizations, but then eventually it clicks and the full realization is there. I think Yogananda said a saint is a sinner that never gave up. That's a very good definition. It's everyday effort. Even though the intellect is not going to get it. So, that's the report of how I feel. I just feel a little woozy, a little lightheaded from low blood pressure. Because I wondered how I was going to feel, because there was this sort of this, I realized there's just something really huge happening. And it did, so it had this little effect. Woke up in the morning feeling this way. I said, uh-oh, I feel a little different this morning. But I actually exercised and ran today, and I felt fine. I didn't feel weak in that way. It was just this low blood pressure. Now, as far as like all the special effects and stuff, which is, I've always been drawn to try and explain to people what we're aiming towards by trying to use some sort of special effects to try and be a better explanation, but I keep getting this information to me that's not the way. We don't need the wah-wah pedal. You know, I don't need your wah-wah. I don't need the wah-wah pedal to make, you know, really great special effects. It's better to keep it very clean, very clear, very simple. So I'm trying to stay away from doing any special effects. Keeping it very dry. Good theme for California. It's like, what was it, 78, 80 degrees today is ridiculous. Every day is the same. No clouds, perfectly clear, like summertime. This is scary. But we can say I don't have a drought problem, I have a continuity problem. If the whole state said that, everybody was saying that around the world, we don't have a drought problem, we have a continuity problem. I guarantee you the drought would vanish. Because whenever we decide that we're going to give up these problems that we have ascribed to ourselves, authorized for ourselves, says, no, I don't have a drought problem. I'm going to decide I'm going to have a continuity problem. I'm going to accept the fact that I have a continuity problem in exchange for the drought problem. So I don't need any other problems except the continuity problem. Because that's actually there. That's actually there. And it gives me, at least I'm able to realize I still have a problem. Instead of having no problems at all, which would freak us out. We're so completely used to problems. If we had no problems at all, ever, we realize we've never had a problem, we never will have a problem, ever, it would freak us out. We'd feel disoriented. So that's the continuity problem. We'd feel very disoriented. And so we do have a problem, which is the continuity problem, and accept it instead of saying, no, I want to get rid of that one too right away. Say, no, I'll accept this one. I'll have this one for a while. I'm happy to have this continuity problem for a while. Because when we accept it, then the remedy for it is there for us. And it's gradually dispelled. But we don't need any of these other problems, which means we can literally see, literally experience like a completely perfect paradise as the cure for the continuity problem. We don't need any of these other problems. So the world could ascend if it took this approach. Everyone could ascend if we take this approach. We say, I don't need this world problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. And if everyone really accepted that, the grace of God would know that there's no more need for this world. And here's a world that solves the continuity problem. Literally, that's what would happen. Now, I believe it's fairly common when you're making profound spiritual progress for there to be slight changes, maybe in your blood pressure, how you feel. Maybe not everybody takes their blood pressure when they feel kind of lightheaded and a little tipsy, and not real stable on their feet, and feel like you might even fall over a little bit. They may not take their blood pressure, but I did, and I said, oh yeah, it is low, for sure. Don't be alarmed. I'll see how it is tomorrow. But this may be part of the ascension process. The ascension process is really about just saying, I don't need all these problems. I don't even have those problems. Because if it weren't for the continuity problem, I would decide I don't want any problems at all. They'd all vanish. They'd all vanish because all of them are, again, an attempt to shrink down an unmanageable fear that we have, which is the fear that God is trying to deprive us of everything. That's totally unmanageable. So we're in this crisis management mode of trying to parse it, shrink the fear down to an extremely tiny, the tiniest point possible. Now, the fourth dimension is simply that they've gone further in shrinking it down. So it's shrunken down to, even tinier point than the third dimension. And so people wrongly think that the fourth dimension is salvation. They say, well, we managed to shrink it down even further. What they don't realize is that the fear is still there. They haven't saved themselves from it at all. It's the wrong direction to go in. They're keeping the desire to be prime greater and then trying to manage the unmanageable fear that comes from that desire. Thinking that shrinking it down, identifying with bodies and things and robots and all this stuff is somehow going to minimize the fear. Well, it seems to do in time. It seems to temporarily minimize it. But the entire complex of the situation is actually still there. The totality of the fear is still there. Nothing has happened as far as to free oneself from it. So the fourth dimension is not the way to go. It is absolutely not the way to go. So, blood pressure is still low. It's still low. Right now I can feel it. Feel a bit woozy. There's a titanic type of just an immense breakthrough has been happening. So yeah, there's something, some facts. The spaciousness thing, I haven't quite had that realization yet, but it's coming. It's coming. You can't force it. No question that what was it, November 4th or something, the day I woke up and I was in the shower and suddenly I understood spaciousness. So I looked up pure spaciousness and I saw Longchenpa, and then I had a dream. I also had a dream where there's this guru, this teacher, and I looked up and saw the statue of Longchenpa and I realized that's who it was. So there was a transmission of clarity at that moment, and in that moment I understood spaciousness. And then the clouds kind of came back in a bit, so I don't quite understand it now. Intellectually, you can't, but it's there. It's there. So it's starting to, you know, it's starting to blossom. So the teachers, they kind of wake us up to, you know, it's a mini wake up. Like you wake up for a minute and then you go back snoozing, right? But then the snooze alarm is on and the alarm rings again. And after about three or four snooze alarms going off, you finally wake up. But we're in a heavy sleep. We're in a heavy, 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 heavy sleep. Heavy forgetfulness. Intense effort to shrink, to manage the unmanageable fear. Because when we project onto God our attempt to dispossess God of reality, we think that God is trying to dispossess us of reality. And so that's an unmanageable fear. It's also an imaginary fear. It's not a true fear, because God is not trying to dispossess us of reality. So it's imaginary, but unmanageable if you don't see it as imaginary. And then we try to manage it by shrinking it down, and we've made incredible efforts at that. Incredible efforts. The vision of oneness is to see that there aren't things separate from spaciousness. You know, that's the vision of oneness. That's the seamless vision. So, you know, it's trying to dawn. It's trying to dawn in me. It's trying. You just have to, you know, be patient. But obviously, just a direct verbal explanation, it doesn't do it. It doesn't do it. I say the mood of repentance is more helpful. Obviously, something in here recognizes that my perception has been completely faulty in seeing, believing that there are things in surrounded by space. Totally faulty, obviously. So there's this incredible stupidity there. And so I'm kind of afraid of becoming fully aware of how incredibly stupid I've been. That's really it. That's why the mood of repentance is super helpful. The more you can practice this, the closer you get to finally recognizing how incredibly stupid, you know, I have been, you have been, we've all been. It would be personal. You'll feel like, oh my gosh, I've been stupid beyond stupid, beyond stupid. There's a limit to stupidity, and we've exceeded the limit, you know, by not realizing that. Things occupy space too. I mean, it's not separate from space, spaciousness, things. Ramana Maharshi said that enlightenment realization is like we're right now, delusion is like an optical illusion, and enlightenment realization is like suddenly seeing the optical illusion. And seeing for what it is, a shift like that, you know, so the shifts where you shift and you suddenly see it a different way. It says just like that, actually, just like that. And it's got something to do with spaciousness and objects and spaciousness for sure. And he says that it's just an easy shift, and suddenly there's a shift, and you recognize that things are not separate from spaciousness. It's not that they're abiding. There's no separation at all. Space is seamless. It's not like when space comes to a wall or something, that oh, there's no space there, and then there's a, you know, it's a part. Okay, there's a wall. There's a thing, and then after the other edge of the thing, now space just then continues on. No, it's a complete, perfect continuum. So. I would suggest, again, the best advice, just as far as a base for your realization, is to the mood of repentance. within that mode of repentance, it's basically absorbing the fact, the realization that you've been very incredibly stupid. It's absorbing that. And when you can absorb it, then the realization comes to you, whatever it may be. You may see the continuity problem. You'll see it. You'll see, oh my gosh. The whole time I never saw that. It's unbelievably stupid. How could I not have seen that? You know, it's like that. That's how it's been with me. The reaction is, oh, how could I not have seen that? That is just, it's just unbelievably stupid. You have to be able to absorb that. The better you can absorb that, then the more quickly these clarifications will arise for you. There's no question about this. So the mood of repentance, it does not have to be, you know, doing much talking or thinking or anything like that. No. It's more like you're prepping yourself to absorb the realization that you've been really stupid and completely overlook something that's totally obvious. And you know, you're just going to say, wow, that was dumb. No wonder why I've been suffering this. I've been super dumb. And I place myself in the exact same place as everybody else. I mean, I've just been incredibly dumb. And the only difference of anyone is how far along you are to absorb that and be able to, say, forgive yourself. You know, really, all forgiveness is self-forgiveness. It's all about forgiving yourself for being incredibly dumb. Dumb and dumber. Really. You know, it's just like, whoa, that was really dumb, and this was even dumber. And not getting angry at yourself. It's just, you know, just some sort of mood of, that's okay, you know, all right. I have to eat crow on this one. It's eating a lot of crow. That's it. The quiet ones who are just, you know, in this mood of repentance, those are the ones that get this unfolding of more and more clarification. So you get up in the morning and your attitude should be, wow, I'm so eager to recognize how dumb I really have been today. I'm really willing to see, you know, my great stupidity today. How I've managed to be so stupid for so long. That's very interesting, actually. This thing about things somehow being severed from space is just like, it's the dumbest thing of all. So, I can definitely feel this whole thing, you know, is fermenting very strongly. And it can for you too, there's no question about it. You just continue this patience, the mood of repentance, and looking at your own mistakes more than others. Don't worry about others, they're making the same mistakes. Everybody has the same problem too, the continuity problem, same for everybody. It's like this, ultimately Longchenpa tells us that you realize everything is nothing but spaciousness. There's only spaciousness. But the intermediate step is to recognize the decorations in spaciousness that are not, it's all one continuum, perfect continuum. But we still perceive form. We still perceive form. But we realize that is not somehow excluding spaciousness at all. Space is not excluded from anywhere. It's everywhere. It permeates everywhere. It's everywhereness. So how could everywhereness stop at the edge of form? Does it stop at this can? You know, everywhereness is not in the can. It's It's around the can? No. Everywhereness is everywhereness. But we can still see form. It's an intermediate step. And there will be a functional understanding of form relative to other form, as far as, you know, two forms don't, you know, they don't go through one another. You think, well, not everything is just pure spaciousness. It should be able to go through one another. But that assumes that pure spaciousness isn't already everywhere, right? So whether some decoration goes through another or not makes no difference at all to everywhereness. So we don't have to go to the ultimate extent realization. We go to the intermediate realization. That's it. That's a lot simpler. Well, it's actually a lot more complex, but that's what we're used to. So that's why it solves a continuity problem. Simpler would be everything is nothing. There's nothing but pure spaciousness. Everywhereness is all there is. That's the simplest. But we're not ready for the simplest because we're used to the complex. So, what I'm feeling is this mood of repentance and sort of this building realization that I spent my whole life in a state of, you know, stupidity, stupefaction. That's kind of a sad thing. It's a very sad thing. But you have to hold some kind of poise you can hold. Inner poise, where you don't feel the sadness. I'm not feeling sad, but I know a regret or anything. It's, no, I don't have any time for that anymore. Just it's a matter of let's get it right now. Let's get it right. But really, the ones in satsang who are feeling like, wow, really, this is so heavy, you know, so heavy for me. It's like, it's almost uncomfortable and they're painful, you know, it's like they're suffering. They say, my God, I'm so stupid. This hurts so bad to be so stupid. Those are the ones that are getting it if they are able to just sit there quietly and suffer with it and just be with it. Just be with it. Don't try to do anything about it. And just get used to it, tolerate it, and it's gradually it diminishes, and you realize that it's not going to overwhelm you. Those are the ones who are succeeding. So you see a satsang maybe, and all these long faces, and people are like miserable, and you can see they're suffering. And then you see another one where people are bubbly and hugging. Oh, I love you so much. Yeah, this is great. You know, where is it happening? Where is it happening? It's the miserable. It's the ones that are feeling their misery that are getting it. Because first, there's no way around accepting the fact that we have been incredibly stupid and dumb. To just insist that somehow spaciousness, everywhereness is limited and it does not involve things, you know, it's just complete whimsy. No basis in fact whatsoever. Not even any basis in any logic whatsoever, actually. It's simply, we just whimsically arrogated this, actually. And then we've covered it with a patina of plausibility, logical plausibility. But it's just a house of cards entirely. Total house of cards. And so, of course, when you see your house of cards crumbling, it's very humbling, isn't it? And the ego is crumbling. And you just say, wow, I spent so much effort building this house of cards, and now it's just crumbling like it's nothing. You know, boy, I was stupid. Why did I waste my time doing that, you know. And then, but don't yell at yourself like, idiot, idiot, you're so dumb, you idiot. Yeah. I actually went out and hit some golf balls today because I'm trying to exercise to get my blood flowing, because it's not flowing enough. It's so dry out here. The grass, they cut it. The fairways are so like hard pan. Grass is cut real close. I couldn't hit the ball off of those fairways, and I was just hitting the ball into the bushes. Must have lost about 10 balls at least. It's incredible, very humiliating. And finally, at the last hole, I figured out how to do it. Figured it out. But up until that point, it was quite humiliating. There were people seeing me. I just hit the ball off just straight into the bushes. You know, it freaked me out. There's no grass to sweep the ball at all. So I've struggled with that. So I looked like a complete idiot out there, really incredibly stupid. But I said, hey, it's okay, you know, I know I'll figure it out. And then finally figured out how to cope with this situation. So it's like that, you're going to look like an idiot. Because especially you're trying to understand it intellectually, you're gonna seem like an idiot because you can't do it. And if you just hang in there and keep your poise, then you know, at some point, almost like, oh, we're running out of time, there's almost no more time, and then somehow you will try something different and suddenly it works. It'll say, oh, okay, I have no more problem then. I'm not stupid. I've given up my stupidity. I've given up what doesn't work. I let go of what doesn't work. I've let go of the stupidity. And then you say, okay, I'm not stupid anymore. But yeah, it's pretty funny. It's pretty funny. I mean, I hit some balls that were such complete shanks off the tee that the ball like rolled directly left off the tee into the bushes, you know. And I mean, I'm looking around, does anybody see that? I said, please, I hope nobody saw that, you know. So I had to put a second ball up. Exact same thing happened again. I said, oh my gosh, it's just, I wasn't coordinated, you know, a lot of stuff going on. And so you hope nobody sees, you know, how incompetent you look. But just keep soldiering on. Just keep soldiering on. There's no, you know, there's no easy remedy to it except just to soldier on. You just keep moving and keep working on it. And don't defend against the stupidity like denying it. No, I'm not stupid. What I've seen in people who are heavily defended is you point out a mistake to them and they absolutely defend that they didn't make a mistake to the death. You know, it's just like all important. So obviously, and I've seen that they go towards the positive type. Everything's great. Everything's wonderful. So beautiful. Hey, you know, life is great. They go to that approach. They're terrified of recognizing how stupid they've been, and they think they can just keep faking it. Like, oh no, I'm not stupid. Look, I'm around giggly people. We're happy. We're entertained. Look at this entertainment. How festive it is. Look at all these colors. Look at all these special effects. Yeah, this is great. Inwardly, though, they just have this utter terror of admitting, you know, how the mistakes, how dumb they've been. Whereas those who are really have made some progress are happy to see, you know, oh, I made a mistake. Oh, well, great. Okay, how do I fix that? Let's look at that. Why did I make that mistake? You know. So yeah. Okay. Now why? And looking at it, just look at it with interest. And also the ones who are making mistakes and refuse to look at it, what they do is they project it onto to others and they insist that, no, I didn't make the mistake, they made the mistake. Our approach is we have to realize we're the ones, our mistakes, we're the ones who believe that spaciousness, everywhereness stops with things and then continues on, and it's, it's not actually everywhereness. We're the ones who are perceiving that, believing that. It's our mistake. We have to accept that we've made this incredible blunder. And so that's where the mood of repentance comes in, where we don't need special effects, we don't need all these songs and dances and fashion shows and all this kind of stuff, and makeovers and entertainment of all types and things. It's better to sit quietly like in a cave, in your little cave, sit quietly and just come to grips with it. Now, you know, it's almost so bad you think we can never live it down. How could we possibly, wow, that is such a, and everybody will criticize and laugh at us, etc. But once you fix it, once you now see space, everywhereness is everywhere, then you're going to be carefree and blissful, and it's going to be a tremendous presence. And so people who laugh at you will just seem to be foolish, actually. So you definitely will be able to live it down. That's not a problem. That's not really a problem. They'll say, "Ha, what a house of cards you build. It just all came tumbling down. Wow, you really don't know how to build the good defenses, do you? We look at our defenses. They're standing strong." But that's simply defending, delusion. So what good is that? Doesn't free you from fear, doesn't free us from suffering, doesn't do, help in any way. What's the point of that? You want the cards to fall. You want the house of cards to fall. You don't want to keep on believing that things are things in themselves separate from spaciousness. And you don't want to keep on believing this fiction. Because then you think you're separate, right? It's all this separate from spaciousness. Everything's fragmented. It's all fragmented. And you think you're living in some different kingdom rather than reality. We're actually dwelling in reality. There's no place other than everywhereness. But we don't see it that way. So we're frightened, we're terrified, we think we're being deprived, we're suffering, etc., all of that. So, mood of repentance. That's the insight, that's the clarity suddenly arise, and you'll see it. And you will say, "Wow, I really missed that one for a long time, didn't I?" So, it's dawning, we'll see how the next day goes. But again, encouragement to everybody to stay in this mood of repentance right now. Stay in this mood. Somber and sober. Ready to absorb the recognition, like, "Oh man, I really... made just a really dumb, I really made it dumb. I've been dumb for a long time. Very dumb. I'm incredibly dumb. But forgive yourself. But be forgiving." Okay. But not just verbally. Forgiveness is let it go. Let it go. Let the dumbness go. Let the dumbness go. And when we do that, no more dumbness, enlightened. Self-realized, that's it. All right, very great. That's it for this one.